Hi, it's time to test if a CD can be used as a diffraction grating and measure a laser's wavelength. In my previous video, I used a real diffraction grating with great results, but maybe a blank CD is all we need. In this video, I'll measure the track spacing on a CDR with lasers and attempt to measure the unknown wavelengths on some red lasers with the CD. Lots of laser beams and reflections this time. Always wear lazy safety glasses when shining lasers at reflected surfaces or being in the beam path, even with weak lasers. A diffraction grating is nothing but a lot of tiny and precise lines with slits between them. The tracks on a CD can act like these slits, more curved than on a linear diffraction grating, but for home use, it's not really an issue. For the experiments, I've chosen to use this CD. It's just a new blank CDR. It may seem like an odd choice to use a blank one, but it isn't completely blank. There's an empty pre-groove track on it. This is more clean than the data track on a written CD, so I recommend using a blank CDR. While you can use the CD as a reflection grating, it is, in my opinion, easier and safer to use it as a common transmission grating. To do this, I will have to remove the reflective aluminium layer on the disc. Alright, I'm not gonna bother with removing all of it. Now for the setup, which is the same as in my previous video, so watch that later for more details. The first thing I need to know is the spacing between the pre-grooved tracks. This is needed as the slit spacing in the calculations. According to the standards set for a CD, it should be 1.6 microns with an acceptable tolerance of 0.1 microns. This may seem precise enough to be useful, but that unknown tolerance will only give me a final wavelength within 70 nanometers. Not good enough to replace even the cheapest diffraction grating. I will need to measure the track spacing on this disc myself with a laser of known wavelength. A green 532 nanometers laser is a good choice for this, so let's go for that. For convenience, I want horizontal dots on the wall with the least possible distortion from the curved tracks on the disc. For that reason, I will use the outer part of the CD where the slits are closer to being linear from the larger diameter of the tracks. In short, I'll aim the laser somewhere around here. Oh yes, that's a diffraction pattern. The centers of the spots are a little more difficult to find than on the small round ones from a linear grating, but it's somewhere around here. Time to measure the distance between the centers of the first order dots. It appears to be around 76 centimeters. Let's zoom in. Well, on the wall, the center of the dot is somewhere between 76.0 and 76.1. Let's call it 76.05 centimeters. With this info, I can calculate the angle like in the previous video where I said it was important to use radians. Turns out I need to brush up on trigonometry. The important part is using the same unit in both formulas and not switch between radians in a spreadsheet and degrees in a calculator. I'll stick with radians since I recommend using a spreadsheet. Alright, here's the angle in radians. Now we can calculate the track spacing on the CD using the grating equation. Hopefully, I will get a result that's within the specs for a CD. Oh, okay, that's right on the edge of the standard. 1.5 microns. Which makes sense when I think about it. A standard CD used to be max 650 megabytes, but now 700 megabytes is common, like the one I use. I guess they found 50 megabytes more on the disc by going for the smallest track spacing allowed in the specs. With closer spacing, you can fit more tracks on the disc. technically a longer spiral track for more data. Let's see if a violet 405 nanometers laser can confirm it. Nice! I think it's fair to say the track spacing on a 700 MB CDR is 1.5 microns. In my two tests with the green and violet laser, I would only have been a nanometer off if I just used 1.5 microns as slit spacing directly in the formulas for calculating wavelength. Not bad for an ordinary CD. Diffraction gratings are usually specified in lines per millimeter. I've got one with 500 lines per millimeter and one with 1000. How many does the CD have? If the track spacing is 1.5 microns, it's just a matter of calculating how many times this will fit on a millimeter. 1 millimeter in meters divided by 1.5 microns in meters equals... hope you don't suffer from hexacosia or hexacontahexaphobia. Okay, so the CD should have 666 2/3 lines per millimeter. Let me try to visualize if the CD really fits in between the two linear diffraction gratings. Here's the setup. With an increasing number of lines per millimeter, the beam should be spread more. Even with my unsteady hands, the grating constant of the CD seems right. So let's find the wavelength on three of my red lasers, which I tested before cutting the CD. In my previous video, I deliberately avoided red laser pointers. As you can tell by the labels, red laser diodes aren't exactly the most consistent when it comes to wavelengths. Typical red laser pointers have a wavelength around 650 to 660 nanometers. Old ones are around 670 nanometers, and in modern, more expensive ones, it can be a more bright 635 nanometers. But there are so many different red diodes and they aren't very precise in their output. The first one for test is a typical keychain PET laser. This one turns out to be 650 nanometers. Nice! The shorter the wavelength for red lasers, the brighter they appear given the same power output. Next up is a tiny pocket laser including a white LED. It's around a more dull 660 nanometers. Here's one of my very first lasers. You can tell by the wear on the label that I've had this for a long time and used it a lot. It has a long wavelength. Let me extend the ruler. This ancient one is a classic 670 nanometers laser diode, now considered obsolete for laser pointers since it is closer to being infrared and therefore not very bright to our eyes. The conclusion of all the tests in this video is clear. You can use a CD as a diffraction grating for weak, unfocused lasers, a nice example of science you can enjoy at your home. I will end the video with a special viewer mail and a little treat for you if you like math. If you have seen enough formulas for today, I can recommend something completely different, like my video about mixing a motor oil and paint pigment. Links in all the usual places. Thanks for watching. Great, you're still here. On my previous video, a viewer FGDS² gave me a tip on how to calculate the wavelength in one go and without complicated functions. Being able to use only a standard calculator is a nice touch. Then I don't have to fool around with radians and degrees. Using his kind comment, I extracted these two formulas. Let's test them with Windows Standard Calculator. I will use the numbers from the violet laser test. Yep, the first one works beautifully. Now for the second one. Works too, but I prefer the smoother first one where memory functions aren't needed. Thanks for the constructive feedback in the comments, it's appreciated. Let's finish off with some extraordinary viewer mail. Spencer Kaup from Ohio sent this package to my PO box. He is taking a class called Industrial Tech and has access to some cool toys. He took a piece of plexiglass and etched my channel's logo onto it, and even cut it out using the laser. Looks really great on its LED base. Thank you so much, Spencer. It's awesome. And good luck with the studies. Alright, hope you enjoyed this little pair of laser videos enough to click thumbs up. I certainly enjoyed making them. Had almost forgotten how fascinating lasers are and how lucky I am to own many of them. But my next video will be about some insane magnets. I will put my 5 largest through some tests. Time to see how well this new monster performs compared to the others. Thanks for watching all the way to the end. Remember to subscribe if you are new here and watched this far. Bye for now.